Good morning, students. Welcome to Machine Integration Live Lectures. In last class, we have seen what is meant by a measurable function and their properties. Okay. That we have shown that if f and g are measurable, then f plus g, some scalar times f plus c, f minus g, these are all measurable functions. Okay. Now we'll see some more properties and also something called Littlewood three principles. Okay. So just a second. So before going to Littlewood three principles, we'll see one more property of this measurable functions. Say result, you can call it lemma, is that if let fn be a sequence of measurable functions, okay, then this supremum of this fn of x, if you want, you can call it supremum of fn n greater than or equal to 1, infimum of fn n greater than or equal to 1, okay, or even lim sup of this sequence fn, lim inf of the sequence fn, they are all measurable functions. Okay, is statement clear? So whenever you have a sequence of measurable functions, then supremum, infimum, lim sup and lim inf, we can also call it this as upper limit and lower limit, they are all measurable functions. Okay, so proof is not a difficult one. Suppose we want to show that this supremum of fn, this set, okay, this is measurable. What is meant by this supremum of fn? It is a function, supremum of fn of x, okay, right? So if we want to show that some f is measurable, what we want to show, if we recall, when we say that f is measurable if the set x such that f of x is less than alpha or greater than alpha, this should be measurable for every alpha real number. Is this definition, remember? A function is said to be measurable if given any real number alpha, all x such that f of x greater than alpha, this set should be measurable set. Is that clear? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
So therefore, now if we want to show that this supremum of fn of x, so call it, let you say h of x, which is equal to supremum of fn of x n greater than or equal to 1, right? So if we want to show that this h of x is measurable, what set we have to consider? Then x such that h of x is greater than alpha, somehow we want to show that it is measurable. Is this clear? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Right? So if this one, this x such that, what is your h of x is greater than alpha, right? That means h of x is supremum of this one. So what is relation between supremum and this h of x and each fn of x? This h of x is supremum, right? That means it is least upper bound. So what we know about least upper bound? So here you can see that here fn of x is always less than or equal to h of x for every n. Is this clear? Because h of x is an upper bound. Are you following?
Yes, sir.
So if at all, see, here this, you have four versions of different things which we have shown, they are all equivalent. So if we take instead of this greater than alpha, if we take less than alpha, if we prove that is also sufficient, yes or no? Yes or no? either greater than, less than, greater than or equal to, less than or equal to, those four variants are equal. Okay. So this set, if h of x is less than alpha, then this is same as saying that, because your h of x is bigger than or equal to fn of x. So it is same as saying that fn of x is less than or equal to h of x, which is less than alpha. This is true for every n. Are you following?
Yes, sir.
If we have greater than alpha here, then we get some union you will get here. That's all. There is nothing wrong in that. This is same as fn of x is less than alpha for all n. Are you following? So if this is true for every n, it is same as saying that intersection of x such that fn of x is less than alpha. Right? Is this clear? X such that h of x is less than alpha is same as saying that intersection of x such that fn of x less than alpha. But what we know, since each fn is measurable, each fn is measurable, we get this set x such that fn of x less than alpha. This belongs to M. Is this clear? Now our M is a sigma algebra. That means the intersection, countable intersection, is also closed. So therefore this less than alpha, it also belongs to M, right? That shows that this intersection is same as x such that h of x is less than alpha. H that h of x is less than alpha, this is also measurable. That means this supremum of fn, okay, this set, this function is measurable function. Any doubt?
Measurable function.
So if you write here greater than alpha, then instead of this intersection, what you will get is union. Okay, so if h of x is greater than alpha, at least one of this fn should be greater than alpha, like that. Then you will get union there. So for easy understanding, you take f of x is less than alpha, then using this one, you will get that fn of x is less than alpha for every n. Is this clear? Yes or no?
Sir, Kaizen with Imran join.
What? Huh? Any problem?
With sir.
Say it again.
Sir, with Imran join.
Similarly, you prove this exercise, simple exercise, that infimum of fn, this function is also measurable. Okay, so for that, what you have to show, what is relation between infimum of fn? Suppose if you call it this as some g of x is infimum of fn of x, then g of x and infimum, because it is greatest lower bound. Okay, so what you get here is greater than or equal to. Are you following? So instead of taking less than alpha, yes, at that time you take greater than alpha, right? Then each fn will be, yes, greater than alpha. So therefore it is intersection. Are you following?
Yes.
So this, it is similar to the above one. Okay. Now what is?
Sir, you need to come, na?
No, if you take here greater than, then you will get intersection, yes, only. If you take less than, then you get union here. Okay,
sir.
Because you are using supremum, we have taken here less than alpha. When you take infimum, you take here greater than alpha, then you get this intersection as it is. You can check that. Are you following?
Okay, sir.
Yes or no? Because if you call it, suppose, yes, sir, g of x as infimum of fn of x, okay, n greater than or equal to 1, then what is the relation between g and f? Because it is greatest lower bound, so you get this one. Is this clear? Right?
Yes, sir.
So therefore, if this is g of x is less than, if this is bigger than alpha, then each fn is bigger than alpha. Okay? Right?
Yes, sir.
So in that way, you get easily, no problem. Now, what is limsup? Limsup of fn. How it is defined? It is same as how limsup of fn of x is defined. Limsup of a function. This is infimum of supremum of these things, right? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
This is, you can call it supremum of fk, k greater than or equal to n, then infimum n greater than or equal to 1, right? Okay, so each this one, so you can call it here x, this is nothing but this one, okay? But each supremum of this fk of x, we know it is measurable, then we are taking infimum of such measurable functions. Are you following? So if you, for example, if you call it some g n of x, which is equal to supremum of fk of x, k greater than or equal to n, okay? So let this, then our lim sup of fn of x, this is actually simply same as what? Infimum of this gn, n greater than or equal to 1. Is this clear? Yes or no? What we have proved is that this supremum of such functions is measurable. So then each gn is measurable. Okay. And lim sup of this one is this. And we also, by exercise, infimum of gn is measurable. This implies lim sup of fn of x is also measurable. Right?
Measurable.
Similarly, lim inf of fn of x is measurable. For lim inf, what is the formula? It is supremum of infimum of those fk's, right? Which is again measurable. Is that clear? Fine. Now, we'll come to that Littlewood three principle. And we'll see roughly what is meant by these statements. So there are three principles, Littlewood three principles, related to measurable sets and measurable functions. So first one is, nearly every measurable set, if you take any measurable set, every measurable set is nearly union of finite intervals. So this statement says that if you take any measurable set, then that can be nearly, almost equally, we can write as union of finite intervals. Okay. And the second statement is that every measurable function is nearly continuous. Okay, that means if you take any measurable function f, then it is almost equivalent to a continuous function. Okay, then the third principle is roughly that every convergent sequence of measurable functions is uniformly convergent. Okay, so that's what are these three principles. Roughly speaking, you take any measurable set, then that is actually, we can write that as, not exactly but nearly, we can write as union of finite intervals. Okay, then every measurable function, it is approximately equal to a continuous function. And if you take a sequence of measurable functions, if at all they are converging pointwise, then they also uniformly converge. Okay, so here is, you can write nearly, even though if it is not exact, but it is near. Okay, these are the roughly speaking about three principles called Littlewood three principles. Is statements clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So we'll see one version of this third one when and for one and two, if somebody want, you can take it as a seminar topic and one can prepare it. If you have any difficulty, you can ask. Okay, it's not a difficult one. So what we'll prove is the following theorem, which is this third version, third principle. So let me define the statement. Let E be a measurable set with finite measure. Okay. And let Fn be a sequence of measurable functions defined on this set E, measurable set E. Okay. And now let F be a real valued function, such that for every x in E, this Fn of x converges to F of x. That means this is same as saying that Fn converges to F pointwise or not on this domain E. Okay. Then when we have this situation, then given epsilon greater than 0 and a delta, any delta positive, there exists a measurable set A, okay, with measure of that set is less than delta, okay, and a natural number N, okay, such that for all x outside this A, that means for all x not in A, okay, what we have, for all n greater than or equal to n, we have fn of x minus f of x is less than epsilon. Okay, so first try to understand this statement, whether this statement is same as this third one or not. Okay, every convergent sequence of measurable functions, that means point wise convergence up to here. If you take this one, what is the meaning of this? For every x in E, fn of x converges to f of x. That means fn converges to f pointwise or not?
Yes.
Okay. So in that situation, what we have here is given epsilon and given any delta, there exists a set E with m of a is less than delta. However, delta you take small, you get this. That means this measure of this set is 0 or not. It is a null set, right? Such that on its complement, x belongs to A complement. What we have here is fn of x minus f of x is less than epsilon. It is true for every x in A complement, right? That shows that this fn converges to f uniformly. Yes or no? This statement,
yes,
is same as saying that is this fn converges to f on this set A complement. Yes or no? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Fine. So proof is not so difficult one. Let's prove this. So proof. We'll
double error.
That double error is for uniform convergence. In real analysis, first semester, we have used that notation, right? It is for uniform convergence. Okay.
Yes.
Fine. So we'll take help of some sets. So define, let Gn, which is x in E, such that this mod fn of x minus f of x is greater than or equal to epsilon. For example, what is g1? G1 is, it is only between f1 and f. So we are taking some x here if mod f1 of x minus f of x is greater than or equal to epsilon. What is g2? G2 is related to f2 and f. Is this clear? And
yes,
take en. Say suppose en, or use capital N or whatever, small anything. Say suppose Ek. Ek is union of Gk, okay, k greater than or equal to Gn, where n greater than or equal to k. That means, suppose if I take, if I say E1, what is meant by saying E1? E1 is nothing but, it is from K1. So that means G1, G2, G3, all those sets. E2 is union of from G2 onwards. Is this clear? Yes or no?
Yes.
So if you want, you can write here some X is here if and only if there is some N such that X is in Gn, right? So this is, if you want to write as a set X in E such that X is in Ek, which is same as X is in union, that means X belongs to Gn for some N greater than or equal to 1. Okay, fine. Now clearly you can see that this G, each Gn, whether this one is a measurable set or not. Each Gn is this, each Gn is measurable or not?
Yes, sir.
Why? Because each Fn is measurable and F is measurable. So since Fn and F are measurable, okay, so Fn minus F is also measurable. Because we have proved that the difference of F, if F and G are measurable, then F plus G, F minus G is measurable, right? This implies this mod Fn of X minus F of X greater than or equal to epsilon, that is also measurable, okay? That means if F is measurable, mod F is also measurable. So mod Fn minus F is measurable, okay? Right? Yes or no? So therefore,
yes, sir.
This whatever you are taking here, this implies each Gn is measurable. Each Gn is measurable. Okay. Now Ek, which is union of, countable union of Gns. So each Ek is also measurable. So we got that each Ek is measurable. Okay. Set. And what we can observe here is that also, what is the relation between Ek plus 1 and Ek? See, for example, E1. E1 is union of G1, G2, G3 and so on. And E2 is union of G2, G3, G4 and so on. Okay. So E2 is contained in E1. E3 is contained in E2 and so on. So Ek plus 1 is contained in Ek. Is this clear? So we have this a decreasing sequence of measurable sets, and not only that, measure of E1. What is measure of E1? Of course, it is a subset of, it is less than or equal to measure of E, and we have assumed that measure of E is finite measure. In this statement, it is a measurable set with finite measure, right? So the measure of E1 is finite, and this sequence is a decreasing sequence. So therefore, if you recall this statement, what we have proved is that measure of the intersection of Ek, k is from 1 to infinity, is same as what? Limit of measure of Ek, k tending to infinity. Whether you remember this statement? If you have a decreasing sequence with measure of E1 finite, then measure of intersection is same as limit of measure of Ek. Is this clear?
Yes.
Now we'll see that this intersection of Ek is actually empty. There won't be any elements, because if X belongs to E, then if X belongs to E, then as Fn of X converges to F of X, what is meaning of this? Given epsilon greater than 0, there exists N0, a natural number, such that mod Fn of X minus F of X is less than epsilon for all n greater than or equal to N0. Is this clear? This is the pointwise convergent definition we are using. Fn of X converges to F of X. Yes or no? If you are not following, please ask me. For pointwise convergence, that means if you take any point, then there is some state such that fn of x minus f of x is less than epsilon. Okay, now using the definition of this gn and ek, okay, what can you say about this x? When x will be in gn, if fn of x minus f of x is greater than or equal to epsilon, is this clear?
Yes sir.
Yes or no? So if x is in gn, then fn of x minus f of x is greater than or equal to epsilon, but here it is less than epsilon. That shows that this x is not in gn. Is this clear? Yes or no? X is not in gn. Is it clear? You take this one and you take this gn statement. If some x is in gn, then fn of x minus f of x should be greater than or equal to epsilon. Is this clear? But by point wise, what we have here is fn of x minus f of x is less than epsilon. Okay, so that shows that x is not in gn for all n greater than or equal to n naught. Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
So x is not there from gn naught, gn naught 1 plus 1, gn naught plus 2 and so on. So x is also not there in en naught. Is this clear? Why? En naught is what? Union of all those gn naughts after that. Are you following?
Yes, sir.
So if you take any x in E, what we have observed is that there exists some n naught, a natural number, such that x is not in en naught. Is that clear? If we take any x in E, then there exists an n naught such that x is not in en naught. This implies, can you see that intersection of ek, k equal to 1 to infinity is empty or not? If at all it is non-empty, then that x should be there in each and every en, right? But if you take any x, then that x should be, is not there at least in one of this e naught. Are you following? Since if at all some x belongs to intersection of ek, then what we are getting here is that x should be there in ek for every k. But this is a contradiction. Why? If you start x in e, then there is at least one en such that x is not in en. Here we are saying that x is in ek for every k. Are you following or not? So therefore, this intersection has to be empty. That means measure of this set, measure of empty set is 0, right? Now, if you use this one, the limit is also 0, right? Are you following? So limit of measure of ek, k tending to infinity is 0. What is meant by saying this m of ek tends to 0? That implies, for this given delta greater than 0, for given any delta greater than 0, there exists a natural number n such that after that stage, this modulus of m of ek, right? M of ek, because measure is positive or non-negative, so you don't need to write modulus. This is less than delta for all k greater than or equal to n. Is this statement clear? From limit equal to 0 means what? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Simply saying that an tends to 0 means after some stage, all an terms should be less than that epsilon or delta, whatever is given, right? So in now you take, because if you see this statement, what we want to show? We want to show that there exists a measurable set A with measure of A is less than delta. So here obviously you can take, take your set A as this E capital N. Are you following? Then measure of A is obviously less than delta. If you take anything bigger than N, it will work, no problem. So simply take at that point N itself. Okay. So measure of A is less than delta, we have proved. Now what we want to prove? That the last statement. If you take any X not in A, then For all n greater than or equal to n, fn of x minus f of x is less than epsilon, we want to show. So start with, let x belongs to a. Let x does not belongs to a. What is a? Our a is en, right? So what is meant by saying that x is not in en? What is en? En is union of
n greater than k.
Gn, Gn n greater than or equal to that capital N. Is this clear? So this en is union of g, k, k greater than or equal to n. Is this clear? So x is not there in this union means what? At least there is one. So that implies x is not there in. X is not, so I'll write here, x is not in the union gk, k greater than or equal to n. Okay, that means x is not there in at least one of them, gn or gn plus 1 or gn plus 2 and so on. Are you following? At least one it should not be there. Is this clear? This shows that
yes, sir.
X is not in gk, okay, for some k greater than or equal to n. Is this clear? Yes or no? At least for 1k, it should be true. Now tell me, what is gk? X is here if it satisfies this. So if x is not here, that means fk of x minus f of x less than epsilon. Okay? Yes or no? So if you want, you write here. Just if you want to use same notation, then you write here. N g n for some n greater than or equal to n. This shows that this mod f n of x minus f of x is less than epsilon, right? For all n greater than or equal to n. Why this for all n greater than or equal to n you can write? If x is not in en, then because it is en plus 1 is contained in. Why this is true? Since en plus 1 is contained in en. So if x is
en
not here, then obviously x cannot be here. Is this clear? Yes or no?
Yes.
So this is true. That shows that this fn converges to f uniformly. Okay. This is about the third principle, okay, which says that fn of x minus f of x is less than epsilon whenever fn converges to f of x pointwise, right? Any problem? This statement, you can even make it weaker. It is not necessary that fn of x converges to f of x at every point. Even if it converges almost everywhere, then also it is true. So that I will write as an exercise and you try to prove it. It is not a difficult one. So your exercise is, what I am saying, this statement, same thing you take, where you have to replace this fn of x converges to f of x almost everywhere. Okay. So if fn of x converges to f of x almost everywhere. Okay, that means where they are not converging, that set measure is zero. Then also the above lemma is true. Okay, so we want to prove that even if fn of x converges to f of x almost everywhere, then also we can show that given epsilon and delta, there exists a measurable set A satisfying these conditions. Okay. So I'll just give a hint. You try it. If you are not getting, I'll explain it. Okay. So what you have to, how you have to select that set is, so let me give hint for a proof. I'll give a hint. What is meant by saying fn of x converges to f of x almost everywhere? What is by definition of saying that fn of x converges to f of x almost everywhere? Means what? Implies there exists a set, measurable set, right? set B with measure of B is 0 such that such that this fn of x converges to f of x for every x belongs to outside this B. That means that E minus B. Are you following? Yes or no? Outside B, it is convergent everywhere. And measure of that set is B is 0. Yes or no? Either is this step clear?
Yes.
So now,
yes, sir.
Now apply. This set is again a measurable set or not? So apply above lemma for this E minus B. This is your new set. Okay. So on this set, it is point-wise convergence. Yes or no? So this set, whatever we are considering, the above result, instead of E, you take E minus B. We know that E minus B is measurable set with finite measure because E itself is finite measure, right? And fn's are sequence of measurable functions and fn of x converges to f of x for every x in E minus B, right? So this much statement is true now for E minus B, exactly point wise, okay? So therefore, the given epsilon and delta, there is a measurable set A satisfying this condition, right? Yes or no? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
So the, when you apply, there exists a measurable set A1 with measure of A1 is less than delta, and for all x outside A1, that condition is satisfied. Now you take your actual set A as this B union A1. Okay. And you can check why we are taking that one. Then what is measure of A? Is measure of B union A1, and we have proved that if measure of B is 0, then measure of B union A1 is same as measure of A1, okay, which is less than delta, right? Now just prove that if x is not in A, then x is not in A1 as well as x is not in B, right? Yes or no? So if x is not in A and A is equal to union of this one, then x is not also in B and x is also not in A1. So if x is not in B, then this condition is true. Okay. Then, and x is not in A1 means by applying previous lemma, you will get this implies mod fn of x minus f of x is less than epsilon. Is this clear? Actually, I, instead of saying hint, I have given entire proof. You have to only rewrite. Any problem?
Yes.
No,
sir.
So, what you have to understand is, this result we are applying for B complement. Almost everywhere convergence, this gives rise to one set, measurable set with M of B 0. And outside B, it is convergent everywhere, point-wise convergent. Okay, so we are applying the previous result for this new measurable set, which is E minus B. Then you will get a set A1, then take A is equal to B union A1 and so on. Okay, so this is all about the first unit. In next class, we'll see more about Lebesgue integration. Okay, so we'll stop here. We'll see in next class.
Okay, sir.